A reading from the book of Numbers. From Mount Hor, the children of Israel set out on the Red Sea Road to bypass the land of Edom. But with their patience worn out by the journey, the people complained against God and Moses. Why have you brought us up from Egypt to die in this desert, where there is no food or water? We are disgusted with this wretched food. In punishment, the Lord sent among the people seraph serpents, which bit the people so that many of them died. Then the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned in complaining against the Lord and you. Pray to the Lord to take the serpents away from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a seraph and mount it on a pole, and whoever looks at it after being bitten will live." Moses accordingly made a bronze serpent and mounted it on a pole. And when anyone who had been bitten by a serpent looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. The word of the Lord.
Out of The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to the Pharisees, "I am going away, and you will look for me, but you will die in your sin. Where I am going, you cannot come." So the Jews said, "He is not going to kill himself, is he? Because he said, 'Where I am going, you cannot come.'" He said to them, "You belong to what is below. I belong to what is above. You belong to this world, but I do not belong to this world. That is why I told you that you will die in your sins. For if you do not believe that I am, you will die in your sins." So they said to him, "Who are you?" Jesus said to them, "What I told you from the beginning. I have much to say about you in condemnation, but the one who sent me is true, and what I heard from him, I tell the world." They did not realize that he was speaking to them of the Father. So Jesus said to them, "When you lift up the Son of Man, then you will realize that I am, and that I do nothing on my own, but I say only what the Father taught me. The one who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, because I always do what is pleasing to him." Because he spoke this way, many came to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Jesus Christ. Who are you? Kind of a paralyzing question, huh? Who are you, right? We usually start to answer that question, our name, of course, we might offer first. What we do is usually second, right? It's interesting how we fall into that. So what do? You know, introduce yourself by your job. The crowd says, but who are you to Jesus? And I just want to highlight a couple of the things he said. I do nothing on my own. The one who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone. If we can flash back a little bit, first of all, just to this past weekend's gospel, the raising of Lazarus, and then further back into the life of Christ, I want to talk more about his identity, how he's able to answer those questions, how he's able to go into the passion because he knows who he is. So this weekend, as the crowd gathered around the tomb, and he asks them to roll back the stone, I don't know if you had the short or long version here. I know Father Ryan, it was probably the short version, wasn't it? Right? And Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you for hearing me. I know that you always hear me. But because the crowd is here, I have said this, that they may believe you sent me." The whole reason he's rolling that stone back is not for his own glory, but so that we would believe in the one who sent him. He is so Father-centered. That's, in John's gospel, really one of the straws that breaks the camel's back. Like, the crowd has had enough of this guy. He's dangerous. We're going to have to put him to death. So we start to think about that. Man, he knew what was coming. What allowed him to get through the passion? I want to go back further before we go forward. All the way to the beginning, to the gospel's start, when he is baptized and Jesus comes up out of the water. Do you remember what he hears from heaven? "This is my beloved son. This is my beloved son." And his public ministry begins. Relationship gives him his identity. His relationship with his Father gives him his identity. I am the Son of the Father. Everything I do is going to point back to the Father. So his mission then comes third: healing preaching, teaching. How did he know when it was time to stick around a town a little longer? There's some more here to do. How did he know it's time to move on? I've got to go to another town. But there's still more to do. See, if he defined himself only on numbers, he fed 5,000, huh? Why not 10, right? How much money do you make? Why not a little more, right? Like, how successfully are you in your work? How big is your house? How long were you able to go on vacation? Why not 2 months, right? Like, vocations work is very dangerous for me. Father, how many seminarians do we have, right? It's easy for me to slip into this mission thinking. How productive am I? And I'm guilty of sliding into that from time to time. Getting down a little bit, like, man, parishes are struggling. They're linking. They're merging. Why can't I bring around more vocations? It can be very self-critical when we slide into thinking that is mission first. When we find our identity in our productiveness, we get really down on ourselves, pretty exhausted. And then the relationships around us are just things we use to be more fruitful in our mission. When it's mission before identity, which decide relationships, we are stuck in the mire. But when we get it right, it's R-I-M. Relationship gives birth to identity, and out of that we find our mission. R-I-M is all that Jesus talks about after washing the disciples' feet. So he starts to move forward through this journey. John's gospel. He washes the feet in chapter 13. You start to hear him give this wicked long homily through chapters 14 and 15. Take a look at it for yourself. It's not going to be in one of the Gospels we see, but during Holy Week, read that. It's Jesus' final homily. He's washed their feet. He knows the garden is coming next in the arrest. Remain in me. Remain in me. As vine on branches, I am in the Father. Remain in me and you will bear much fruit. In 10 verses, he says, remain in me 7 times. Pretty clear mission statement. In fact, politicians are taught that. You want someone to remember your point in your political speech? Say it 7 times. Jesus had that nailed, right? Remain in me as I am in the Father. Relationship, identity, mission. Whew, I can already feel myself relaxing. I am the beloved Son of the Father. And out of that love, he's asked me to be a priest. And oh yeah, by the way, the bishop asked me to work on vocations, you know? But when I go to bed at night, I'm still the beloved Son of the Father. And I'm trying to serve him as a priest. And I pray, Lord, make those seeds grow. I can sleep a little easier when I'm not putting mission first. And each one of you can do the same thing, thinking about that in your life. That's what drives Jesus onward through each of these hard moments. This I had to steal from the music director. It's not even in your pews yet, all right? Coming this weekend will be the new Missalette, all right? They probably have slave labor when the school kids come over and switch these all out on Friday, all right? I used to get a pizza party when I was growing up doing that, all right? So here's a few highlights from Sunday, right? Jesus is at the Last Supper. I tell you, from now on, I shall not drink the fruit of the vine until the day I drink of it with you in the kingdom of my Father. Jesus is always Father-centered. Then he goes out to the garden to pray. My Father, if it is possible, let this pass from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. He finds the boys asleep, right? Withdrawing to pray a second time. My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done. He finds them sleeping again. Returns a third time to pray, saying the same thing again. In his most passionate moment, Father-centered, Father-centered. Peter, little ambitious, gets his sword out, right? Cuts at his ear of the slave. Put your sword back in its sheath. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? Who provides? The Father. Jesus is so confident as a son that his Father is in control of this whole narrative. As he's being interviewed, he is silent. He has an answer. Until when? Are you the Son of God? Now it's time to talk. You asked about my daddy, right? He speaks up. You say so. We'll hear that Sunday as we read through the Passion. And because of that commitment, that steadfastness, he gets all the way to the cross. One of the last things you'll hear Sunday, after he dies, the crowd, you will have to say this line, truly this was the Son of God, right? That faithfulness to the Father brings faith to the crowd. I think too often we look at the cross, we're like, man, that's awesome. Like, my Jesus endured all this whipping. Man, he loves me. Sure. Sure, you can pray that way. But it starts to glorify some of the pain instead of saying, what did Jesus really focus on to get through that? His relationship with the Father. That the pain is secondary. The relationship is what keeps him going. He's not like, okay, let's see how much. Yeah, bring it on. Come on, do it again. You don't hear him egging on the crowd, do you? No. It's not just a show of his strength or ability to endure. It's a fidelity to the Father that keeps him going. Thursday. You'll all be back, right? Holy Thursday? Good. Some people say, I'm busy, I'm working. It's worth it. It's a great Mass to come to. It really is a special one. Just a couple lines from Thursday. Before the feast of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to pass from this world to the Father. He knew what? Time to go to the Father. Fully aware that the Father had put everything into his power. He knows who's in control of this narrative Thursday. Friday, we'll read the Passion again. I won't go through that over again. You will. What do they say at the resurrection? He is not here. He has been raised. Do you hear that? Who's in control of that? The Father, right? He has been raised. Relationship gives birth to identity, and he finds his mission. And when life gets tough, it's not a matter of just trying to gut it out and endure it. It's eyes focused on the Father. You know, he didn't just hear that comment, this is my beloved son, at his baptism. Yes, it launched his public ministry, but he heard it a second time. Do you remember when? The Transfiguration, right? And from there he journeys to Jerusalem. It's a message that Jesus had to hear more than once. It's all right that we need to hear it over and over again. You are the beloved son. You are the beloved daughter. And when we hold on to that relationship, when we are Father-centered, our identity is so grounded that we're not afraid. Think of the changes in life that get to us. Retirement. What am I going to do? Don't take away my work. Is that where your identity is coming from? It's hard. Don't take away my health. What will I do? See the panic in that? I'm the beloved son of the Father. That's what matters. Who I am, not what I do. I think we all want to rest in that as much as we can. So this Holy Week, keep your focus where Jesus had his, on the Father.